Marc Whitehead and Associates wants you to better understand the Social Security disability hearing process, so we developed this video. In the video, you will learn the kinds of things people discuss during a hearing. Marc Whitehead and Associates focuses on disability cases, and from application to award, we offer a personalized solution to your unique disability situation. Over the years, we have seen our clients get nervous about their court appearances. Just like you, they are hardworking people who now have some serious health issues and have had to apply for disability benefits and got denied. Now they have a lot of questions as they get ready for their court date. This short video will not show everything that takes place in a hearing, and we cannot predict what will happen during your own hearing. We developed this video to give you some insight into the hearing process in hopes that it may reduce the stress or worry about the hearing. Please contact us with any questions you may have after watching the video.
Good morning. Are you Mr. Ken Brandt?
Yes.
Good morning, Mr. Brandt. My name is Judge Crenshaw, and I am the ALJ assigned to hear your case. We are here today because you requested a hearing before an impartial ALJ. Today we will admit evidence and take testimony. When we are done, I will prepare and publish a decision. I'm not bound by any prior decisions in your case. Other people in the room are the hearing reporter, whose job it is to make a record of the proceedings, and a vocational witness, Ms. Wright. Ms. Wright does not work for the Social Security Administration. She is an independent vocational consultant whose job is to assess the occupational impact of various restrictions you may have. She will let us know whether those restrictions would have an adverse effect on your past work, as well as your ability to perform other work in the local, regional, and national economies. And that, in a nutshell, is what we will be looking at today. What kind of health problems you have, whether those problems are severe, how those problems limit you, and how those limitations impact your ability to perform not only your past work, but also your ability to sustain any other work that exists in significant numbers. Finally, you will see a microphone in front of you. Please talk in a conversational volume so we can hear you and so your voice gets properly recorded. If you mumble or talk low, we may have to come back and do this all over. Finally, the microphone cannot pick up motion. If you point to something and say, "This hurts," whoever listens to the tape will not know what you mean. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Good. Any objections to the exhibits of record?
The ALJ is asking the attorney about any objections as to the proposed evidence. The hearing officer will produce a CD of your proof. You can ask your attorney for a copy. Most of the evidence is almost always going to be admissible. Many objections go to the weight of the evidence, not to its admissibility. One area that is always objectionable is other people's proof in your file. If there's a medical record on someone else, that is objectionable, and the offending material is stricken.
Okay. Show the proposed exhibits 1A through 30F admitted. Is there anything outstanding? Do we need to keep the record open?
The ALJ needs to know if you have outstanding requests for medical reports, records, assessments, and so forth. This is fairly common. Most ALJs will allow a few weeks after the hearing to secure final proof.
Yes, sir. I have one request from a treating medical provider. 10 days, sir.
Show the record open for 10 days after the conclusion of testimony. Counsel, any problem with your client taking an oath?
No, sir.
Mr. Brandt, please raise your right hand. Do you hereby swear or affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth?
Yes.
Okay. Some ALJs like the attorney to give a brief opening statement that summarizes the medical proof and gives the ALJ literally a how and why the case should be paid. Your attorney can tell you if your ALJ requires this type of opening.
Yes, sir, I would. I'll be brief, Your Honor. First thing I'd like to point out is that my client has rock-solid earnings for the last 20 years. I think that speaks volumes about his work ethic, the implication being if he could work, he would, because it's what he's done all his life. By way of objective medical proof, sir, this man's had two spinal surgeries. You'll find that the first op note was 9-22-08. It's in Exhibit 6F, page 2, sir. That was a fusion. The fusion actually failed, Your Honor, and he went on to have a second spinal surgery, that date being 4309, and you will find that in Exhibit 12F, page 8, Your Honor. I think the objective evidence in this case is compelling, sir. I think my client's very credible, and I hope that when you reach the merits of the case, you'll find for his favor.
The attorney might continue with the additional details. We are now about to start the testimony. Some ALJs do all the talking. Some let the attorney talk, and some fall somewhere in between. The point is to follow the lead of your attorney. If the ALJ asks most questions pertinent to your case, then your attorney will not have many questions left to ask. There are no bonus points for repeating the ALJ's questions, so don't take it out on your attorney if your ALJ asks most of the questions.
Okay, then, I'll ask some questions and then let your attorney take over. Let's make sure we have the name and address correct. I have Ken Brandt, 2720 Golden Lane, Louisville, Kentucky, 40223. Is that correct?
Yes.
I have your date of birth as 3/2/1958, making you 50 as of the date you became disabled and 52 today. Is that correct?
Yes.
I have you as a high school graduate, no college, no trade schools. Is that correct?
Yes.
Can you read and write?
Yes.
Add and subtract?
Yes.
The ALJ continues to get basic information in this portion of the hearing.
Any work of any kind since May 2nd, 2008?
No, sir.
You had some third quarter 2008 earnings reported on your Social Security number. We ran these earnings queries just before the hearings. This tends to suggest you may have worked in the third quarter of 2008, which is after you became disabled. Can you tell me what that represents?
Yes, I had some sick pay and vacation time due when I resigned. I have the pay stubs that show that.
Okay then, counsel, can you get me a copy of those stubs so I can put them in the record?
Yes, sir.
I have no doubt here that this man was not working, but you never know who looks at these records down the road.
Here the ALJ is protecting everyone from delays in the case. The SSA runs queries to check and see if there are any reported earnings after the date that the claimant indicated that he or she became disabled. If there are reported earnings for any reason, such as work activity, insurance payments, sick or vacation leave, then the ALJ will need an explanation. You should always let your attorney know about any earnings, especially if you are working.
Your attorney provided a very detailed written description of the exertional demands of your past work. It is in Exhibit 14E. Let me show it to you. Can you show it to me? Is that description accurate?
Yes. My attorney and I worked on this together. He explained to me the detail you'd need as far as the lifting and the standing and the walking and the sitting. I might add the job was very fast-paced.
I would expect that. Let me ask the VE something. Ms. Wright, are you satisfied with the quality of the vocational exhibits in the file, especially Exhibit 15E? I will need you to provide a job analysis from a skill and exertional perspective.
Yes, sir. It's more than adequate for my purposes.
Counsel, if it is agreeable, we can dispense with further job descriptions. The record is extremely well developed in this regard. There is only one job in the last 15 years. The VE is satisfied, as am I.
Yes, sir, that'll be fine. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Brandt, I'm going to let your attorney take over and examine you as to what is wrong with you and how that makes you disabled under the SSA rules. Counsel, proceed.
The ALJ turns the questioning over to the attorney. Remember, some ALJs do this themselves. Just ask your attorney how your ALJ proceeds. We pick up during the testimony.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Brandt, even though I'm seated beside you asking you questions, I really want you to direct your testimony towards the judge. He needs to hear you to be able to help you. I know it's a little awkward, but go ahead and look that way as you answer the questions, if you would, please. And by the way, if you don't understand one of my own questions, just let me know. I'll make any clarifications you need. I want to talk about why we're here today and what's wrong with you. And tell me, what part of your body is injured, sir?
That's my lower back. I fell backwards and kind of twisted. I felt a pop and then a warmth in my lower back.
Okay. After this fall, did you go to the ER?
Well, I went the next morning. My back was killing me. They gave me a shot and took some x-rays, told me to go see my own doctor, which I did the next morning. He ordered more x-rays and set me up for physical therapy, which was a bust. 3 weeks later, my back was still killing me. I was having pain in my leg then, so he sent me in for an MRI.
Okay, so you had both back pain and leg pain, sir?
Yes.
Testimony continues on what happened leading up to and after the second surgery. There is a good description of the claimant's pain as part of a hearing. Most ALJs are interested in the claimant's opinion about what he can and cannot do. We pick up with questions about current activity.
How long can you stay seated in an upright chair at one time, sir?
15 to 20 minutes at one time.
Okay. Standing and walking, are you limited in that, sir?
Yes.
Go ahead.
I can't walk far without having to sit down.
Okay. Can you give me an idea of what far is these days?
Across a room, sometimes a little longer, not much. If I do manage, if I manage a trip to the store, I have to double up on the pain meds. I have to lay down as soon as I get home.
Okay.
There's days I even need help. I need help getting dressed. I can't bend well, so just putting on my socks and shoes can be a challenge.
What about lifting and carrying? Is there a weight or object you've learned you won't go beyond because it bothers you?
I avoid that. Maybe a gallon of milk, but not too often. I try not to lift from the floor because I hate bending.
Okay, I think I understand. Sometimes it helps the judge understand the level of your pain if you rate it. We typically use a pain scale of 0 to 10 here. 0 is basically pain-free. You're back at your job. Things are good. 10's horrible, knock me out, pain, ready for more surgery kind of stuff. Can you tell me on average, most days, most of the time, where do you rank your pain, sir?
I'd say most days an 8 if, with the pain meds if I'm careful.
Never relents then?
No.
Okay. I tell you what, just put this out plain. Tell this judge why you can't work anymore.
Well, it's just the chronic pain. I can't function well anymore. There's days I need help getting dressed. It kills me to bend. Putting on my socks and shoes, it's just a challenge.
I've heard enough. Let me just ask the VE something. Ms. Wright, characterize the past work, please.
The past work was medium in exertion per the DOT. At times heavy per the vocational exhibits, semi-skilled in nature with an SVP of a 3 to 4 depending on the job task on any given day. The job description and the DOD description are similar, the exception being that he may lift over 50 pounds depending on the workflow. That's not uncommon.
Here the VE characterizes the past work in terms of its physical exertion and the skill required to do the work. There is a resource called the DOT. And the VE usually relies on it to characterize the work. The ALJ has to compare what he thinks you can still do physically and mentally against the demands of your past work to see if you can still do it.
Okay, any skills transferable to sedentary work?
No.
Would there be... Okay, assume I have a hypothetical worker of the same age, education, and work experience. This worker is limited to, at best, sedentary work, but that such work must have an option to stand briefly every 30 to 45 minutes, no more than occasional bending. The worker must have a cane available to him. Could he do his past work?
No.
Would there be any light exertional work?
No.
Okay. If I accept his self-described functional limitations, to include the incidence of pain as he relates it, his postural limits on sitting, standing, and walking, would there be any work he could perform in the national economy?
No, he cannot maintain posture long enough, and he would experience frequent lapses in concentration on job tasks, either of which precludes all work.
Okay, there are some state assessments that include 3F and 9F. If I find those credible and controlling, could he do his past work?
No.
Any light work?
Yes, a limited range of light work.
Up until this question, things were going very well. The VE kept saying no jobs. With this question, the VE found certain jobs. What happened was the ALJ asked the VE about some other medical opinions and proof in the record. In this case, the proof was medical evidence from non-treating, non-examining physicians employed by state agencies. Now, these are called state agency assessments, and they show up in just about every case. The SSA has contracts with each state, and employees of those state agencies end up making the lower-level medical determinations in most cases. Here, the ALJ is showing that he is aware of those assessments and that he will factor them into his decision. The ALJ has to show that he is aware of the medical opinion proof in the record, no matter what its source. For example, if the SSA sent you out for an exam, there would be a report, and the ALJ would create a question from it, or at least comment upon it in his final decision.
Okay. There was considerable medical evidence admitted after the last state agency assessment, and it is quite compelling. Further, I find this man credible. All in all, I find there is sufficient evidence to allow me to determine a more appropriate and more limited RFC for this man.
The way this hearing is gone, there's no need for the attorney to cross-examine the VE. In many other cases, the VE will identify certain jobs. Your attorney can then ask the VE specific questions about those jobs.
I have all I need. Thank you for coming in today. I will try to get a decision published as soon as possible.
We hope you found this video helpful as you get ready for your own hearing. If you have taken notes or have any specific questions, please contact us. We have a few final tips for you. What to wear to court. We advise that you wear the same casual clothing that you wear around the house. However, you should avoid shorts or any clothing with suggestive or offensive language written on them. Do not dress up in formal or business clothing. Remember, the point of the hearing is to demonstrate that you cannot work. How long will this take? Most hearings will take around 1 hour, but this can vary. When will I hear from the ALJ? Most judges will tell you at the hearing that it takes 30 to 60 days before they will issue a decision, but this will vary from judge to judge. A couple more things. Please turn your cell phone off and show up 45 minutes early. Good luck to you. From application to award, we are here for you to develop a personalized solution to your unique disability situation.